Okay, now shall move on to one more phylum, the general cats of the phylum Coelenterata. The phylum Coelenterata, it is also known as Cnidaria. Coelenterata, that is phylum Coelenterata or Cnidaria. Again, this phylum includes the aquatic animals. They are all aquatic animals. Mostly they are marine forms and few are freshwater forms. So, based on the body nature of the animals, they may be called as Coelenterates or Cnidarians. The terms is Coel and Enterata. Coel means body cavity. They possess body cavity. So, those animals, they are with the body cavity, they are called Coelenterates here. And again, why they are called as Cnidarians? Why they kept under separate phylum as Cnidaria? Because they possess cnidoblast cells in the on the body wall, okay, on the tentacles and the body. So they are called as Cnidarians. They kept under a separate phylum and called them as Cnidaria. Again, they are aquatic animals. They are sessile animals or free swimming forms. You know what is sessile? In the previous phylum, I told you, sessile means they are attached to the substratum. They are incapable to move. They are always attached to the substratum. In this group, there are sessile animals and also free swimming forms. On the body and on the tentacles, they possess specialized cells known as cnidoblast cells or cnidocytes. They contain stinging capsules. So, because of stinging capsule, these cnidoblast cells or cnidocytes, they are also called as the stinging cells or nematocytes. So, you can use any term here for these cells: cnidoblast cells, cnidocytes, stinging cells, and nematocytes. They possess tentacles for movement or for capturing food materials. The cnidoblast cells or cnidocytes, they are meant for three functions. One is for anchorage, for the attachment to the other organisms. That is anchorage. Again, for defense mechanism. Then for capturing prey. They are free swimming forms. They may capture the prey by using cnidoblast cells. Even in sessile animals, they are also used for capturing prey along with the water current. If the food materials reach the animal, they may capture the food materials. Again, about the body organization, there is a tissue level of body organization. They are diploblastic. So, again, I am not going to explain in detail what of diploblasticity. You know what is diploblastic? Ectoderm and endoderm. The body wall encloses a cavity. The body wall encloses a cavity, what we call as gastrovascular cavity. For example, in case of the hydra, the body wall encloses a cavity. So, this is called as cavity or a space. This is called as gastrovascular cavity. Gastrovascular cavity. It opens to the exterior by means of an opening, and that is called as mouth. It opens on hypostome. It opens on hypostome. And this meant for collection, intake of food materials into the gastrovascular cavity. Why this space is called as gastrovascular cavity? We have seen the body cavity in the sponges. I told you about spongocele. Here we call this as a gastrovascular cavity. Gastro refers to digestion. In these animals, the digestion of food materials taken place in the body cavity or gastrovascular cavity. That's why it should be gastrovascular cavity. In other terms, the saline traits, also known as seal enterons, this seal they possess inside, they call as a seal enterate. The digestion may be with both intracellular and extracellular. The cells lined here in the gastrovascular cavity, they meant for the digestion of food materials. Some cases, the digestion may be taken place within the cells. It is called as intracellular digestion. And this gastrovascular cavity meant for digestion of food materials. They may release the enzymes here, digestive components here to digest the food. So it is said to be extracellular. In saline traits, you can see both intracellular digestion and extracellular digestion. Some of them, they have the skeleton which is composed by the calcium carbonate. This type of skeleton can be seen in the corals. There is a deposition of calcium carbonate around the body. It is like a skeleton, within that there is an animal. They are all called as corals. The saline traits, they exhibit in two forms. One is a polyps and medusa. Polyps are sessile forms and medusa are free living forms or free swimming forms. Polyps are again cylindrical or in different form. Example, again in case of Adamsia, it is commonly known as sea anemone. Their body is cylindrical. And the free swimming forms, what you call medusae, medusa plural, medusa singular, they are umbrella shaped body and made for easy swimming. They may swim in water. They are free swimming forms. The saline traits exist in two forms. They exhibit alternative generation. Exhibit alternative generation. The process of the exhibition of the animals with alternative generation is called as metagenesis. What are these two alternative generation, the results and they what is the existence of these animals? One is a polyp, another is a medusa. Polyps produce a medusa, polyps produce a medusa through asexual reproduction. They reproduce asexually to form the medusa, and again medusa form the polyps. That is through sexual method of reproduction. So in saline traits or in cnidarians, two types of reproduction can be seen, both asexual and sexual method. Polyps may produce medusae through asexual reproduction and medusa form the polyps through sexual method of reproduction. Example for this process, that is one of the saline traits, that is the obelia. The reproduction, as I told you, sexual or asexual. In asexual method, budding can be seen in Hydra, and sexual method is there in some organisms, and their fertilization maybe external development is indirect. Examples for the salient traits. There are some examples. One is Fazolia. It is commonly known as Portuguese man of war. So, in a picture, there is a first diagram, there is a blue color diagram, there is a Portuguese man of war or Fazolia. On the top, there is a nematophore, it is filled with air. So, because of the nematophore, it floats on the surface of water and remaining parts of the animal body which within the water, they are all zooids for the collection of food materials, as dactylozoids for digestion, gastrozoids, and reproduction, gonozoids are there. And one more example, that is Gorgonia. It is commonly known as sea fan. Gorgonia, it is commonly known as sea fan. This look like an expanded structure. And one more example, Spinetula. It is commonly known as sea pen. Sea pen. One more example, that is Adamsia. Already I told you, that is sea anemone. Sea anemone. Then one more is a Meandrina. It is commonly known as brain coral. Brain coral. Another example, Corallum rubrum. Corallum rubrum. It is commonly known as the red coral. I think most of you know about the use of red coral. So, in Kannada it is said to be Kempu Havalagalu. Kempu Havala. It is used in the manufacture of jewelry ornaments. One more example is Fungia. It is commonly known as mushroom coral. It looks like the mushroom, the umbrella shape of the mushroom. So, it is to be Fungia. So, there are different examples. One more is Aurelia. Commonly known as the jellyfishes. Okay, jellyfishes. So, these are the general characters and examples of phylum Coelenterata or Cnidaria. One more phylum, that is Ctenophora. So, Ctenophora is one of the minor phylum, as it includes very less number of animals in the group. Ctenophora. Again, they are marine forms, exclusively marine forms. They are commonly known as sea walnuts or comb jellies. Sea walnuts or comb jellies. Comb jellies. They are radially symmetrical, like in case of the Cnidarians, diploblastic with tissue level of organization. So, body organization in Ctenophorans similar to that of the Cnidarians or Coelenterates. So, one of the important character of the Ctenophorans, they bear 8 external rows of ciliary comb plates. Ciliary comb plates. These meant for locomotion. These meant for locomotion. Meant for locomotion. As like in Coelenterates, in Ctenophorans, the digestion again intracellular and extracellular. They have one more important character, bioluminescence property. bioluminescence. You know what is a bioluminescence? The emission of light by the living organisms. Emission of light. So these group of animals, they emit light. So they are called some bioluminescent organisms, bioluminescent animals. So what characteristics involved in these animals for the emission of light? So just for information, not all the animals, they emit light. Only some animals, some animal organisms, they emit light because their body cells, they contain some chemicals, that is luciferin and luciferase. So these chemicals helpful for the emission of light during their metabolism or during their reaction. So those animals, they emit light, they are all called as bioluminescent animals. And the sexes are not separate. Again, these are hermaphrodites. So an important character must be know about hermaphrodites. Hermaphroditic. Sexes are not separate. That means both the sexes are present in the same animal. Male and female reproductive organs or reproductive structures present in the same animal. The same animal may produce male gametes and female gametes. Such type of animals are called as a hermaphrodites or bisexual animals. Bisexual animals. Reproduction by only sexual methods. Reproduction by sexual method only. There are no asexual reproduction in this group. Sexual method. Fertilization is external. That means fertilization of the gametes, fusion of the gametes should be taken place outside the body, that is in the aquatic medium, because these are all aquatic animals. The development is indirect. So in animals, I am going to use two terms. That is with reference to the development of the organisms. Direct development and indirect development. Here in case of ctenophorans, there is a indirect development. That means the development of the organism through the larval forms or many larval stages. Many larval forms, that is called as indirect development. Example for this, what we call as a ctenoplana. Next we shall move on to one more phylum, that is Platyhelminthes. The term says Platyhelminthes. It has two terms. Platyhelminthes. The term says two meanings. One is platy and helminthes. Platyhelminthes. Platy means flattened. Helminthes means worms. Their body is dorsoventrally flattened. Their body is dorsoventrally flattened. So they are called flatworms. What it means? What is the meaning of dorsoventrally? For better understanding, I am going to say the positions and directions of the animals. Just for example, imagine this is an animal or this is an animal. Imagine this is an anterior region or front region and this is a back or posterior. Front always to be anterior. Back is always said to be posterior. The upper surface of the body or upper region of the body is said to be dorsal, and the lower is said to be ventral. Dorsal, ventral, anterior, posterior, and there are two lateral sides. If you know about this, if you remember this, you can easily understand what is the flattened nature, either dorsoventrally or laterally compressed body. In flatworms or in platyhelminthes, animals of this group, the body is dorsoventrally flattened or dorsoventrally compressed to form a long ribbon-like or leaf-like structure. Long ribbon-like or leaf-like structures. So that's why it should be dorsoventrally flattened animals. Mostly they are endoparasites. They are all parasites, they are endoparasites in animals, including human beings. Only few are the free living forms. Most of the animals are endoparasites of animals, including human beings. Like tapeworm is an endoparasite of man. Liver fluke, it is an endoparasite of sheep. Again, they are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, and acoelomate animals. Bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, and acoelomate animals with organ level of organization. So these are the first group of animals raising organ level of organization. Before this group, we have seen only tissue level of organization. Organ is a group of tissues to perform the particular function. And what are the important characters of the animals of this group? As I told them, most of them are parasites. To lead the parasitic life, they have some peculiar structures. Hooks and suckers. All the parasites, they are with the hooks and the suckers. So before that, you can understand what are the parasites. Paravalambigal, it's the parasites. Parasites means, jawed animals, they depend on other organisms for their food and shelter. Yava pranigalu, atho yava jeevigalu, tamma aharakkagi mattu iruvikegagi bere pranigalanna avalambisikoltave, adakke navu parasites atho paravalambigalu anta karitivi. So in these animals, there are specialist structures for their attachment to the host organism or host organ. They use the hooks. And to get the nutrients from the host body, they may use the suckers to suck the nutrients. Presence of hooks and suckers in parasites to absorb nutrients from the host organisms. For digestion, so after intake of food material, after absorption of nutrients, so actually they need a digestive system in animals. But in case of these parasites, the digestive system is not well developed because they may suck digested food materials from the host body. Adikkeli jeernanga vyuhagalu bekagodilla. Already, jiranagira padarthagala sthetagoltade, there is no further digestion of food materials. So, they lack digestive system or they have not well developed a digestive system. Again, for elimination of the unwanted materials or the excretory products or metabolic waste, they are the specialized cells known as phloem cells. These meant for osmoregulation and excretion. Osmoregulation and excretion. Now what is osmoregulation? It is a maintenance of body salts and water. This is osmoregulation. And exhalation eliminates the process of elimination of nitrogenous waste materials from the body. So both the functions will be performed by the flame cells. The flatworms, again they have the neural system with a longer what you call as a narrow cord system with the different nerves. One more important character of these animals, again sexes are not separate, they are all hermaphrodites. Hermaphrodites. Fertilization is internal because both the gametes are produced by the same animal. Same animal, they possess the male reproductive system and female reproductive system. Male system, they produce the male gametes, that is sperms, and female reproductive system produce the female gametes like the ova or eggs. They may be released into the body, into their own body, not to the exterior. The fertilization may be taken place inside the body, okay, that is internal fertilization, or fertilization is internal. And development is through larval stage. There are different larval stages in their development. So some of the members of this group possess high regeneration capacity. High regeneration, regeneration. Now what is regeneration? The term says generation, production. Regeneration, don't say reproduction, but regrowth of the structures. So regeneration, it means the regrowth of the lost part of the body. Regrowth of the lost part of the body, and it resembles the lost part. For example, in planaria, so one of the animal of this group, that is a planaria. If you cut the animal here, if you remove this part, or due to any reason, if this part is removed, this part is lost. After some time, the lost part may be regrown. That is called as regeneration. Regrowth of the lost part. In planarians of the phylum Platyhelminthes have high rate of regeneration. So one of the important character of this group, and examples for this group, that is planaria. One is a planaria. Again, one more is a Tinea solium. Tinea solium, it is commonly known as tapeworm. Tapeworm is one of the endoparasite of man or human beings, found in the intestine. Even it may grows up to the meters in length, and they may attaches to the inner wall of the intestine by the presence of hooks and suckers. They produce large number of eggs. Within a short period of time, they may produce large number of worms. And one more example, that is a fasciola. Fasciola hepatica. It is commonly called as liver fluke. Liver fluke. It is an endoparasite of the sheep. Endoparasite of a sheep. So in the diagram you can see. First one is a long ribbon like structure. There is a Tinea solium or the tapeworm. Second one is a liver fluke. So on the liver fluke you can see there is one dark patch, that is nothing but acetabulum, or meant for the attachment of the animal to suck the nutrients. So this is one phylum, and examples of the phylum. So one more phylum, that is Ascelminthes. This is the phylum with the higher group of organisms, Ascelminthes. The term says Ascelminthes. It has two meanings, Asc and Elminthes. Osc refers to rounds or circular, and Elminthes refers to worms. In cross section, they appear like circular or round in appearance, so they are called as roundworms. These are also worms. Because of the circular nature or rounded nature, they may be called as roundworms. If you take any animal of this group, their body with a circular in nature or round in nature. What are the general characters of the phylum? Again, they are in different forms. They are found in different regions. One, they are terrestrial, aquatic, again parasitic, and free living forms also there, terrestrial and aquatic free living forms. And there are some animals, they are parasitic, mostly endoparasitic. Their body is elongated with the two extremities, with the two extremities, anterior and posterior extremities. Anterior end possesses the mouth with eversible pharynx, and posterior end with the anus or cloaca. And they are not, they are usually unsegmented. There is no segmentation here. They are unsegmented animals. They are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, and pseudocoelomate animals. Bilaterally symmetrical, the cut passes center in only one plane to get the two equal parts. Triploblastic, three dermal layers are there, ectoderm, endoderm, mesoderm. And pseudocoelomates, there is a body cavity and there are no coelomic epithelium. So that should be pseudocoelomates. Bilaterally symmetrical and pseudocoelomates. And they exhibit sexual dimorphism. They exhibit sexual dimorphism. Males are differ from females. Males are shorter than the females, or females are longer than males. There is sexual dimorphism. With respect to the digestion, there is again extracellular digestion, because they are with a well developed digestive system. So in the previous phylum, we have seen incomplete digestive system or lack of digestive system. Here in case of Ascelminthes, the digestive system is well developed with a long tubular structure with two openings, anterior mouth, posterior anus. Again, for osmoregulation and excretion, there are the specialized structures which are advanced over the excretory structures of previous group. Here there are the coelomoducts. There are some duct-like structures, they meant for osmoregulation and the excretion. Coelomoducts. The sexes are separate. That's why I told you. There are the sexual dimorphism. Males and females are easily identified based on morphological features. they possess one more important character. There's a syncytial body wall. It's a very important character in these animals. Syncytial body wall. What it means? Below the skin, there is a multinucleated non-cellular layer is closely attached to the body wall. That is a syncytial body wall. Multinucleated non-cellular layer attaches to the body wall, so it is to be syncytial body wall. With respect to the reproduction, there is a sexual reproduction. They reproduce by sexual method. Sexual method of reproduction. Fertilization is internal. Development may be direct or indirect. Fertilization is internal. Fusion of male and female gametes within the body. So fertilization is internal, and development may be direct or indirect. In some there is a direct development, in some there is an indirect development. The young ones, they resemble the adults, resembles the adult forms. So these are general characters. And about the examples of this group, so in the picture, so on the screen you can see there are two pictures. One is a round one. There are two worms are there. So one female and one male. In another picture, there are the group of worms, the collection of worms. There are round worms. And examples for the phylum Ascalminthes. One is Ascaris. One is a Ascaris, commonly called as roundworms. Again, one more is that is what we call as filarial worm or Uchereria bancrofti. Uchereria bancrofti, that is filarial worm. Filarial worm. And one more is Ancylostoma. It is commonly called as hookworm. Again, one more is Dracunculus, that is pinworm. Again, one more is Rhabdites, that is soil nematode. Soil nematode. So, just I want to give little bit some information about this, because very important, because most of the people, they are infected by the worms through several media. One is Ascaris, a round one. These are endoparasites of man, and the excessive production of these worms within the host body or the host individual, they may cause a disease called as ascariasis. Ascariasis. Again, one more example. There is a Uchereria bancrofti. It is commonly called as filarial worm. It may cause a disease known as filariasis or elephantiasis. Filariasis or elephantiasis. It's a common disease caused by the worm. So in Kannada it is called as Anekalu Roga, swelling of the lower limbs and lower part of the body. Anekalu Roga. So it may not be cured. early prevention is there for the disease. And again, ancylostoma, it is again a parasite of human beings. It is commonly called as hookworm. It is found in the dermis of the skin. Again, trichanculus is an endoparasite of man, that is a pinworm. And rhabdoides is a soil nematode which may cause the diseases. It may damage the roots of the plants. So these are the few examples of the phylum Ascalminthes. Phylum, that is a phylum Annelida. Phylum Annelida, as the term says, Annelida. So anne means rings. See, the names of each phylum is given based on the characters of the animals. This phylum includes the animals with many segments, and these segments arranged one above the other or in serial, they are looking like rings. They are arranged like rings. Okay, anne means rings. They possess ring-like structures on the body called as annelids. Again, these are mostly terrestrial. Some are aquatic, and few are parasitic. They are terrestrial, aquatic, and few are parasitic animals. The body is again triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical, and they are true coelomate animals. So before that, we have seen acoelomate animals, pseudocoelomate animals. Here and afterwards, all the animals of the phyla, after Annelida, including Annelida, all are with the true coelom, they are true coelomates. Bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, coelomate animals, coelomates. The body is elongated, the body is elongated, and the body is metamerically segmented. The body is metamerically segmented. Already I told about the segmentation. Internally and externally, the body is divided into a number of compartments. And each compartment is said to be segment. It is called as a segment. And because of presence of the many segments here, divides the body internally and externally till the end of the body. It is a metamerically segmented, so it is segment also called as metamere. Metamere, the segment also called as metamere or somite. You can say any term. Again, the body has two ends, anterior and posterior. There is some advancement over the previous group of animals. Possessing the long dish system with the mouth and anus at their opposite ends. Again, the appearance of the tentacles in these animals for different functions. What are the important characters of the phylum Annelida? Metamerical segmentation, the coelomates, triploblastic, bilateral symmetry, again elongated body with the well developed structures. There are the locomotory structures in these animals, that is in annelids. Parapodia, that is in case of the marine forms. There are the lateral extensions to the body known as parapodia. You can see the first diagram. There are some projections in on the body. There are called parapodia, that is in the nares for locomotion. And in case of the one more diagram below that, there is a leech. Again, in leech, the locomotory structures are suckers. There are two suckers, one in the anterior for suck the food materials, and there is one more sucker on the posterior that is meant for locomotion. And one more animal is there, there is an earthworm. Okay, in earthworm there are the minute or microscopic locomotory structures known as setae, which are located in the skin. Setae for locomotion. Again, in case of annelids, the digestion is extracellular, not intracellular. That is the extracellular digestion is there. And about the respiration takes place through the general body surface. With respect to the circulatory system, in this group of animals, the circulatory system is closed type. So many of you know about earthworm, it's a familiar to you. Ellaru eravulu nodirthara. Adralli what is the color of blood? Circulatory system. There is a closed type of circulatory system. Closed type. There are the hearts, lateral hearts or ventral hearts here for pumping blood, and the blood passes through the blood vessels and they reach the cells or tissues. So because of presence of blood vessels here, we can call closed circulatory system. You know about the color of the blood of earthworm, that is red because of presence of hemoglobin. But only one difference, hemoglobin, one difference between the blood of these animals and higher animals like the vertebrates, the hemoglobin which is present in the plasma in earthworm. In case of higher animals including human beings, the hemoglobin present in the RBC. But because of hemoglobin, the color of the blood becomes a red. Okay. So what about excretion? Excretion and the osmoregulation again performed by the nephridia. So there is a advancement over the previous group for excretion and osmoregulation. There are the highly coiled tubular structures known as nephridia. With respect to the organism for reproduction, the sexes are separate or united. Some of them are hermaphrodites or bisexual animals, and some are unisexual animals. Sexes are separate or united. For example, these are unisexual animals or dioecious animals. You can say dioecious. The animal with only one type of sex organ, either male or female. Example, that is Neris. Dioecious animal. Again, about earthworm and leeches, they are hermaphrodites or bisexual animals, both male and female reproductive organs present in the same animal. So they are called as a hermaphrodites or bisexual animals. So they can have sexes are not separate until eradunu on the animal ali erote adake bisexual animals. About the reproduction, they reproduce by sexual method of reproduction. Fertilization is internal, development is direct or indirect. In bisexual animals, development is direct. In unisexual animals or dioecious animals, the development is indirect. Okay? In bisexual animals, development is directs in dioecious animals development is indirect. It's a very important character in the phylum Annelida. And what are the examples here? So few examples I'm going to show and I'm going to mention. One is Peritima examples. Peritima. Okay. Peritima postuma. Okay. Again, Megascolex. Tubifex. So these are all commonly called as earthworms. Earthworms. Again, one more is Neris. So earthworms are terrestrial. Again, Neris is a marine form. It is commonly called as clamworm. Clamworm. So one more example, that is a what we call as Arenicola. Arenicola. Again, Sabella. It is commonly called as peacock worm. Peacock worm. Okay. One more is Hirudinaria. It is a Indian cattle leech. Cattle leech. So in the picture you can see three animals. The first one is the Neris. Again below that there are the Hirudinaria or leeches. Again the big diagram, that is a earthworm. So on the earthworm you can see there are the markings there. Even in Neris also you can see the markings. So that is for metamerical segmentation. So for about these animals, I am going to mention some important characters here. Hirudinaria or Indian cattle leeches, they act as the ectoparasites. They are blood sucking animals, okay, and semi aquatic. Even there are terrestrial and semi aquatic, they may feed on blood of other animals. So they are called as sanguivorous animals.